Thanks. Now, allow me to get going. I'll start with a couple of requests that we'll have to keep the mobile phones and smartphones switched off. There are a couple of rooms that are kept empty to the extent we can occupy them, that's fine. It reminds me of my student days. Wherever I found the space, I could sit there, whether it's there or not, so feel free to do that if you like to, and that's fine as well. First of all, a huge welcome to all of you who have gathered here today. Before I introduce you to the dignitaries on the dais, maybe I could introduce you all to the dignitaries on the dais. That is, among the audiences today, we have the members of Pune International Center. There are members of Maratha Chamber of Commerce. There are also members of the TAI, the NASCOM. There are members of CII. Of course, there are alumni association members of IITB. I must mention that because many of them are of course only for that reason. So, so I think wanting to be safe, I must mention that there are members of IITB around here and also them. There are faculty members and students of various institutional members of PIC also around. Pune being the headquarters of the command, we also have also retired senior uniform service officers also in Pune. In TASC or the other institutions, they also actively come and attend programs. There are quite a few of those coming today. There are lots and lots of entrepreneurs and young students there, as you can see. And then there's an interested connector who never want to lose such an opportunity to come and listen to someone like you. That's the audience. It's an honor to be here and introducing you to the dignitaries on the dais. We are here to release the book that's Rebooting India, Realizing the Indian Aspirations. It's written by Dr. Nandan Nilekani and Guru Shah. Very few of you, or almost none of you, would ever need introduction to any one of those, but such is an honor that I must do my job. Nandan Nilekani, co-founder and former CEO of Infosys Technologies, was founding chairman of the unique identification authority of India, Aadhaar, as you famously know it. He was author of the book, Imagining India. He was twice listed as one of the top 100 most influential people in the world by Time magazine. In 2014, he was awarded the Economist Innovation Award in the category of Economic and Social Innovation. He has been actively supporting various entrepreneurial, for-profit and non-profit organizations, along with Mrs. Rohini Nilekani, that you are aware of. Please put your hands together to welcome Mr. Nandan Nilekani. As I proceed, I must also welcome Mrs. Nilekani to come and take seats here. We are thankful that Dr. Mashilkar, Dr. Ramnath Mashilkar, President of Pune International Center, kindly agreed to chair the session today. We also have Mr. Ravi Pandit, who is honorary treasurer of EIC. And I know that you have to change the schedule to make sure that you will be here, and you did that. Very thankful. This goes back to 24th of September 2011. Unfortunately, we don't have more diaries amongst us today. But these are the people who launched Pune International Center. And it's an honor. We are almost 4.5 years down the line, and we have them here today. Without taking much time, may I first request Dr. Mashilkar to release the book Rebooting India. So,
indeed,
has given us an opportunity to reciprocate by releasing this book on Rebooting India. And it's indeed my pleasure. Nandan has been a dear friend, and I would think that he's our industry's contribution to the country. Our industry, being the IT industry's contribution to the country. Rebooting India is an extremely well-researched and an interesting book. It's a book which grows out of this conviction that technology can make extraordinary impact on any country. On a country as large, as diverse, as poor, as India. And in this book, which has a funny sweep, he talks about how can we reboot our healthcare, how can we reboot our transportation sector, how can we reboot our education, how can we reboot our governmental activities, how can we reboot our banking sector, and the like. As the person who launched Aadhaar in India, Nandan has a very close connect with the urban India as well as the rural India. And the knowledge of both these sectors, knowledge of both these areas, is reflected clearly when you read the book that he has written. It's very invigorating. In a state where sometimes you feel backward about how can our problems be solved, you see a ray of hope, especially by the usage of technology. And like professional that he's precise in his computations and calculations. So he talks about how 101 people, you know, 10 weeks of language and the Prime Minister can make an impact that can be life transforming in a country like India. I have read the book with interest, and I'm sure so will you. I'm not going to stand between you and Nandan's presentation. So let me over to you.
Thank you, Ravi, and it's great to be back in Pune after the inauguration of BIC 4 years back in September of 2011, and really delighted that Dr. Bandilkar is here, only Miss Dr. Kelkar, who is now in Bangalore when I am here, so that's the only thing. But I mean, it's great that I'm here, and I just want a brief update on the activities of the BIC, and it's remarkable what we've achieved in the last 4 years. And I think it's well on its way to Pune back as the preeminent intellectual capital. Delighted to be here. I'll speak about the book in two parts. I'll first speak about some of the ideas and some of the underlying hypotheses behind the book. And then I'll actually do a presentation which will walk you through a specific technology platform which we built, which I think has immense social and economic benefits. So I think, as Ravi mentioned, this book and my work for the last 5 years has stemmed from the belief that if we're going to really address India's challenges, India's, given its size, given its diversity, and most importantly, given the urgency that we have to solve issues very diverse and complex, that using technology and enabling innovation is the only way to go about it. And Mashankar has done so much work on innovation. So this book comes from that belief that technology, appropriately used, obviously you have to think it through and make sure it's done properly, is able to be done at speed and scale to transform a country in ways that you can't ever think of. And I'll talk about some actual examples of the work that we did. That's the first sort of premise, that technology and judicially applied at scale and speed can make a difference. The second point, which is important, is that how do you do it? Because I think we need to understand how to create an innovation society. Now, obviously, some part of an innovation society is creating the artifacts of innovation, creating the research, creating the markets, creating those kinds of things, creating the labs, creating the ways for people to take ideas out and so on. But the other way of thinking about innovation is for government to build what I call as platforms. And then on those platforms, letting innovation happen. And that's one way to think about innovation, is to build government funds and build platforms on which then private and other innovators can actually build solutions on top of that. But the two great examples of such platforms in the world, one is the internet. The internet, as you know, entirely by the US government. It was built by the US Department of Defense. The purpose of the internet was to have secure communication among organs and computers. And that led to the definition, the design of what is called as TCP/IP, which is the language of communication between computers. But this was 40 years back. And then much later, in CERN, again funded by Swiss, by European governments, was the development of the so-called World Wide Web, WWW. This is in the early 90s. And the web was a layer on top of the internet, which allowed you to use the internet pretty easily. So you just enter a website and go and see it. So www.pic.in or whatever.org would bring you to your website. And then on top of that was another government-funded innovation, the browser, which was developed at the University of Lena Urbana-Champaign, funded by the US supercomputing effort, which led to the browser for Mozart, which then led to Netscape, which then led to the Internet Explorer, and then it led to the Internet as we know it. And then once that happened, and so far it was all government funding, after that private industry took over, and that led to the rise of all these Internet companies like Google or Facebook and so on. So fundamentally, government laid a infrastructure of innovation by creating an internet platform, and then other people were able to build applications for that. So that's one example of a great platform created by government but used by innovators, which as you know has created trillions of dollars of market value. You just look at the market cap of the top four internet companies, Google, Facebook, Amazon, and Apple, is $1.5 billion. So clearly, innovation can happen once in other platform. The second example of the platform is GPS, Global Positioning Systems, again funded by US government, essentially for a military purpose of being able to missile guidance and targeting. And that led to a system of satellite, geostationary satellites, which allowed you to pinpoint any location on Earth. And then, sometime about 15 years back, in the last few months of the Clinton administration, this technology was put out for commercial use. So anybody could use GPS to write as an application. And then the technology made it quicker and quicker, and ultimately you had GPS receivers in smartphones. And that technology of GPS laid the foundation for maps. So all the things that we use, like Google Maps or Apple Maps, or whatever map you use, Open Map, Open Streetwear, any map that you use, fundamentally use GPS. That in turn led to innovations like Uber, which allowed you to book a taxi on a phone, which led to driverless cars, and many, many applications of GPS all the time. So there again, the initial entire funding running to billions of dollars was done by the US government, but today innovation is happening around GPS. So both these are examples of how the government funds the technology platform, which only governments can do, and then opens it up so that many people can build all kinds of innovation on top of it. So clearly, 40 years back, when the internet was conceived, people did anticipate how these applications would come. 15 years back, when GPS was put in the public domain, nobody thought that there would be a driverless car in 15 years. So I think, therefore, the way to think about this is, what are those fundamental platforms that governments can build, and then let them lose for innovation to happen? That's the second sort of implicit thing in what I'm talking about. The third thing is, how do you do innovation? Okay, suppose you do want to build such platforms in government. The building of the platform itself is a very innovative activity. It can't be done the usual way. You can't have departments and circulars and bureaucrats and all this stuff. It has to be done in a very agile manner. And governments have many strengths. They have scale, they have systems, they have processes, but innovative big thinking, unless you have something CSR, unless you can do that, it's very difficult to innovation. So I said that the way to do innovation in government is to create startups. In other words, how do you create within the governmental structure a startup which can deliver a particular platform and then move on? And then that platform can be opened up for other people to build on. And many of the big things in India, development have been through startups. I mean, the nuclear program would not have happened, but for Homi Bhabha's support from Nehru and getting it done. The space program, Sarabhai, Sarish Dhawan and others. Even the NHAI, in some sense, was a startup 15 years back, was creating a foundation for the Golden Quadrilateral. So I make the argument that Porter and I, Bilal Chan, I make the argument that the way to think about solving these large problems is to create these kind of startups. And there we built upon our own experience. So when we did the Aadhaar project, the Aadhaar project was a startup inside the government. When I went to work in the government, I was employee number one of this organization. And all I had was a piece of paper that said, give an ID to every Indian and nothing else. And I had a rented and borrowed office in the planning council. And I was very fortunate that the first person I selected to join this group was IAS officer called Ram Sevak Sharma, who is currently the chairman of the TRAI, very famous for his outstanding order on net neutrality. So Ram Sevak was an IAS guy, but he was a very different kind of a bureaucrat who did programming as a hobby. So you know, I don't know how many guys in bureaucracy do programming as a hobby, but he spent his weekends writing code or something. So anyway, he was quite a risk taker. So he said, come, I'll join you. So he joined me, and then we had a small bunch of people to do this project. And we also realized that to pull off a project of this scale and size, you really require the best talent from around the world. At the same time, it's very difficult to attract that talent into the government system. So we set up a unique structure where we allow people from around the world, people of Indian origin, to contribute as volunteers or come and do a sabbatical with us or do an internship with us. And so we assembled a team of both people from within the government who are high-level bureaucrats, IAS or IPS or IRS or Indian Postal Service, you know, all the services we have, Indian Railway Service and so on. And we brought in entrepreneurs and technologists who came on a purely voluntary basis because they felt they have the chance to contribute to a nation-building exercise. And among the most complex things is managing these two worlds, because the world of bureaucracy is structure, hierarchy, everybody stands up when you enter the room, the senior most guy can speak and the rest of the guys keep quiet. Whereas the culture of startup is shorts, t-shirts, anybody can start. Very different culture, hierarchy less. So our challenge was how do we bring these two cultures together? And that actually was the most difficult. And we did that in part because we had the administrative office of UID in Delhi, and we had the technology office in Bangalore. So we sort of kept them in two places. But at the same time, we basically what we found was that because the goal was very large, people sort of rallied to the cause, and people said the goal is bigger than our differences of culture, and I think we're able to somehow get it done. And what we learned also from that exercise was that you have to make the goal large. Because the goal is small, then it doesn't enthuse people or energize people. So we set up a goal. I joined the government in July 2009 and had a meeting with the Prime Minister in August. And so they asked us, how many IDs will you build in 5 years? So I thought of it and I came up with a figure of 400 billion. And then 400 billion started looking small because 400 billion is only one third of India. I said, then they'll ask me, you know, just 400 billion is not a big deal. So we just scratched out the 400 or 600 billion. So that's how targets are set by. Targets are not set by some great analysis. You just take a shot in the dark. So I said 600 billion sounds good. If you can say half the population in 5 years, then they'll probably accept that argument. So we stood up and said 600 billion and went public with that goal. This again, many people in government said you never give targets in government because you know, you're bound to fail and then you look foolish. So never, never, ever come into anything. But the advantage of committing to that 600 billion goal was that it gave a common target for everyone to achieve. And the target was so difficult that all the differences were forgotten. So somehow we had to get there. And the good news was that the goal at that time was to do 600 million Aadhaars in 5 years. And we thought that we would end up spending about 10,000 to 15,000 crores to do it. In reality, we got to 600 billion in 4.5 years, and we spent less than 6,000 crores. Run a company in the private sector, which I did for many years as CEO of Pune. running a company, there is rational behavior in the sense that all companies are measured by the same metrics. So whether you run a software company, a FMCG company, or a hospitality company, the measures of success are the same. You're measured by revenue and growth in revenue, by profits and growth in profits, by growth in market share, earnings per share, and so on and so forth. So it's very easy to say whether somebody is successful or not based on the financial performance of profit and loss or growth. So, and the decisions you make in a private company are limited to your core group, your management team. Some issues go to the board, some issues go to the shareholders. Occasionally you have to go and talk to all the analysts if you make a major acquisition or something. But fundamentally the world of decision making is in your universe. But the moment you go into the public space, first of all, there are many, many people who have a point of view. You're dealing with politicians, bureaucrats, cabinet, parliament, judicial activists, lawyers, judges, journalists, you name it. Everybody has a point of view on what you're doing. And also, it is colored by ideology, because there's no one definition of success. It's not like revenue for a company, right? So somebody, if you achieve something, in somebody's eyes, that's a good thing. In somebody else's eyes, it's a bad thing. And therefore, when there's no one definition of success, it's much more difficult to navigate, because nobody will unanimously agree that it'll work. So that's a big lesson, and part of the reason that many people in the private sector are not as successful as they can be, they don't understand that this is a different world, and you need to navigate in this world with a different set of mental models. And I think the lesson that we learned was that you have to keep your solution as simple as possible. And I'll talk about that in the other part of the how we designed a simple solution, but designed it in a layered manner so that over time it became a very sophisticated solution, but began in a very simple manner. Simplicity is very important. Simplicity gets you speed and scale. And the other thing is that I think the importance thing of trying to make it as bipartisan as possible. So I wanted to make sure that this project didn't get derailed to the political system. So I made it a point to approach everyone about it in the sense that in the first 1 year of the project, I went to each and every state and met the chief minister and the chief secretary and all the bureaucrats and explained to them what was coming so that they knew what to expect. I met all leaders of political parties, I met everybody, every ministry, every department, and I made it a point to evangelize the message across everybody. And it is also about my belief that if I want the support of all these people, I should go to them rather than have them come to me. It's a very fundamental concept. I mean, someone who's been a salesman, you don't make the customer come to you, you go to the customer. So here's weird coming to these people. Which is why I said rather than make them come to my office in Delhi, I will go to Raipur or Bhubaneswar or Patna or Guwahati and meet them in their office or their sort of headquarters so that they appreciate the seriousness of this. And I even made a point that if I had a meeting in Delhi with a chief minister, I would go to his bhavan and not make him come to my office. So for example, when I had to meet Dr. Raman Singh, I went to the Chhattisgarh bhavan to meet him. When I had to meet Sushil Modi, the deputy chief minister of Bihar, then I went to Bihar bhavan to meet him. It's a small subtle thing, but the message is that you're important to me and therefore I will come to your premise and meet you. So with this philosophy, we are able to do a big buy-in across all the different state governments, and that was the heart of it. The entire thing was done voluntarily. There was nothing was forced. Every state of the country signed up with this. Every ministry signed up with this. So being able to go and convince all these guys to come onto a common platform is really the most complex thing. But that's what we did by going out and building that. And I think that's a big lesson if you're trying to do these massive government projects, that you have to reach out to everyone and create a sort of a unanimity of support, and that's the only way that you can make it work. So with this, I thought I'll lay down some of the background. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk you through a presentation of something that we did, and I'll try to make it as simple as possible in the sense, make it as non-technical as possible. Yeah. So what we did over the last 6 years, and now we sort of put together, and we have named this as the India Stack. India Stack simply is a set of software that allows us to do applications which have three attributes. And I want you to think carefully about them. One is presence-less. Now, what does presence-less mean? Presence-less means that I don't have to go somewhere to get it, to get a job done. I mean, today, if I have to go and open a bank account, I have to go to the bank branch and open the bank account. Or I have to go to the government office to get a certificate. But what if I could open the bank account in my house? What if the certificate came to me while I was working in the office? Is there a way to design things so that I don't have to be physically present when I do something? And we call that presence-less. The second thing is paperless. Paperless is simple to understand that how to design a system with no paper. How do you make sure that everything is electronic and therefore it's somewhere up there in the cloud, it can all be done that type of a button. The third thing we talk about is how to make it cashless. In other words, instead of making paper payments, how can you electronically make payments? And the entire work we have done in the last 6 years is now culminating in the ability to make things presence-less, paperless, and cashless. And I'll talk a little more about that. Now, the foundation of this presence-less, paperless, and cashless is something that this government has called GAM. It's a nice acronym, GAM. GAM is stand for Jandan, Aadhaar, and Mobile. Jandan is the Prime Minister's program to get everyone to have a bank account. Aadhaar is the unique ID which I just talked about. Mobile is mobile, between other mobile. And the theory is that if everybody has a bank account, if everybody has an Aadhaar number, if everybody has a phone, then you can do all kinds of things. You can do things, deliver services to people in a way never possible before. Now, the Jandan program has been pushed a lot by this government, and something like 200 million bank accounts have been opened. Clearly, the bank account opening is happening. But what's interesting is at the very same time that the government is pushing bank account opening, another important thing has happened, which is that the regulator, the Reserve Bank of India, has accelerated competition in banking by giving 21 new bank licenses in the last 6 months. Now this is historical because in the last 60 years, only 14 bank licenses have been given. 10 of them were given in 1994, IDBI Bank, ICICI Bank, and two were given in 01, like Kotak and Yes Bank, and then two were given in 2014, Bandhan and IDFC Bank. And suddenly 21 new people have been given bank licenses. These includes telecom companies, it includes SBI and Reliance, it includes all kinds of startups, Paytm has a bank license. Suddenly, because of the regulator's innovation, suddenly the intensity of banking has gone up because they will all come on board in the next 12 months. And the combination of the government pushing bank accounts and these private companies coming, new banks coming in, is going to make sure that within the next 5-6 years, everybody is connected to the financial system with some kind of a bank account or payment product. That's number one. The second thing is Aadhaar. Aadhaar issued today has crossed 980 million. It's adding by, by a month or so, it will be a billion. So, billion people will have Aadhaar, and certainly everybody will have Aadhaar in the next. How many people here have Aadhaar? So billion people will have Aadhaar. So, that means, and Aadhaar is a digital ID. It's not, back there you may have it and think of it as a card, but its fundamental value is a digital ID on the cloud, on the online world, which I can verify biometrically wherever I am, using my fingerprint or my iris. And that is also how you become presence-less. So Aadhaar is becoming a billion. The third thing is with the rise of smartphones. Currently, India has about 200 million smartphones. We have about a billion phones, but we have about 800 million feature phones and 200 million smartphones. But we are adding smartphones at the rate of 25 million a quarter. And yesterday somebody announced some bells, some legal bells, some bells that you 250 smartphones. Anyway, maybe 250 but fundamentally smartphone prices are falling and we can expect smartphones to come. Today you get very good ones at 5,000-6,000 rupees, they'll fall to 2,000-3,000 rupees. And therefore, it's reasonable to expect that in the next 3-4 years, at least 500 to 700 million of the billion phones will be smartphones. So, in other words, the foundation is being laid. Everybody will have a bank account, either because government pressure or competition. Everybody will have an Aadhaar, already a million people have it. And everybody, almost everybody will have a phone for sure. And the majority of them, 60-70% of them will be smartphones in the next 3-4 years. So this led to what we call as India Stack, which is built on this. So for example, using this capability, India has built the world's largest cash transfer program. So for example, the DVD subsidy is now entirely a cash transfer. So the 140 million people today are getting about 8 transactions a year. For a billion transactions, is cash coming into bank account. Why is this important? Because earlier, the subsidy was in the price of the LPG cylinder. If you have to work 800, you can get it for 500. The moment you have an underpriced product to its market price, it has diversion. And you know, you only have public players. The moment you can sell the cylinder at 800 and you pay it as cash into the bank account, then that becomes a market operation. Private players will also come into the business, competition, all that. So removing subsidies from the price and making a separate cash injection is the heart of reform. And so we have built the world largest reform in subsidy. So all these things were done. And so over the time we built the all these various capabilities which are explained in detail as you go up. So as I said, Aadhaar number, 12-digit number, unique lifetime number, using iris and fingerprints, both iris and fingerprints, and unique across a billion people, and the very simple information that is there, name, address, date of birth, sex, and mobile ID and email ID. Using this, I can do an authentication. Authentication means, as I said, I can go somewhere and put my finger or check my eye and confirm that I'm there. Now, this has many uses. One of the big uses of this government is biometric attendance for government employees. Today, about 300 to 400,000 people are doing daily attendance using Aadhaar all over the country, central government. So they literally point the finger and that confirms that they came to work at 9:29 and all the data must be going somewhere. So that's that. But it can also be used for things where they are not there. A very important thing which is being introduced, which hopefully will pick up steam in the next few years, is a program for pensioners called Jeevan Praman. I don't know how many pension people here on pension, but how they're using this. Jeevan Praman is to solve a unique issue for pensioners, because when you're getting a government pension or what's called a service pension, you have to prove that you're alive. I know you're aware of this. On the life certificate. Every year you have to go to some office and show that you are alive. It's a very painful process, you have to go and stand in the queue or whatever. And suppose you are, you know, ailing, then you can't even go. So, government introduced something called Jeevan Praman, where if you go and do a biometric Aadhaar verification at any location, that is tantamount to being alive. So you don't have to, for example, you can then go to any location which has an Aadhaar device and authenticate yourself. Or somebody has a mobile unit, come to your house and you can authenticate and prove that you are right. So suddenly you are made presenceless. You can go anywhere and do things. So presenceless is what Aadhaar authentication does. The next thing which this does is that it has something called KYC or electronic KYC or electronic know your customer. This again is important, very important, because whenever you want to buy something, they ask you for KYC. Say passport ka xerox karo, bank card xerox karo, Aadhaar xerox karo, they are very complicated. And this whether you are opening a bank account, buying an insurance policy, buying a SIM card, buying a pension product, buying a mutual fund. Today, for all these, it will take a few years for it to be rolled out so that everybody is using it. You can do this electronically using your Aadhaar. So now in many banks, you can put your Aadhaar number, put your finger on a device, authenticate and do a KYC and open a bank. Or you can do that for mutual funds. So suddenly, buying or onboarding yourself into a new system has become paperless. The other thing which we have done is some something called e-sign. E-sign basically allows you to sign a document digitally using Aadhaar. Why is this important? Because today, for many transactions, they need what is called as a wet signature. They want you to sign with a pen or a piece of paper. The moment you have a wet signature, it becomes expensive. You have to, you know, somebody has to go sign, etc. And the moment it becomes expensive, then it actually excludes people. So e-sign allows you to do a digital signature with Aadhaar. And then we have designed a system which we call as the digital locker, which allows you to store your documents electronically in a secure manner for a billion people. And what this does is that it's smart of making it paperless. Because so let's say if you want to graduate from Pune University, then Pune University can put your degree certificates and transcripts digitally signed in a locker, send you the address, then you can go for a job interview. Instead of having photocopies, you can just say, pick it up from my locker, and they can copy it. So that makes the whole thing paperless. So that eKYC, digital signature, and this locker essentially are all the things you need to build a paperless system. And then we have built something which is being launched. We had a technical launch last week in Bangalore. We're having a launch with the RBI governor on April 8th, which allows what we call as unified payment interface. It allows any mobile phone to pay money to any mobile phone. Very simple system that will make online commerce very simple. So all your e-commerce and IRCTC, rail booking, all these things will get simplified. The payment will get simplified. So this is again coming live in the next few months. And then of course we are trying to do something about creating what we call as a consent architecture. Basically saying how to put people in charge of their own data. So if I want a loan, I should be able to get data from whichever source and give it to the bank and tell it to give me a loan. Therefore, how do you make this happen again for a lot of people? That's something they're doing. So all this stuff which I described is all. India is the only country in the world which has these platforms. And all these platforms have been built with public investment. They are not platforms built by private companies. They're built with public investment, just like the internet was built or the GPS was built. But they have been built with the intention of allowing innovation to happen. So these are only providing the backbone. They are only providing a way to do things. But these are open for anyone to build on top. Like when we had an event last week on UPI in Bangalore, there were some 75 startups who wanted to use this for various applications. So we believe the future is that government enables things through platforms and then throws it open for innovators, companies, startups, anyone to build on that. So this is a very unique thing which we have in India, which allows you to build presenceless, paperless, and cashless transactions. And I hope that in the coming budget they will extend this to other products like fertilizer and so forth. So over time, you know, more and more things will become cash transfers. And apart from cleaning up the subsidy regime, they also make India more and more cashless because money will go electronically into people's bank accounts. The other important thing, which is happening, which again has big implications, is that India is going from being data poor to data rich in 5 years. What does this mean? Today, there is no, for the vast majority of people, there's just no data about themselves. There's no data. But now, suddenly, everything is coming together, right? When you start making payments through your digital payment, then your data on your digital payment is free. When you start doing prepaid recharge using digital payment, then you don't go home to recharge your phone. When you use social media, there's social media activity. When a business pays a VAT or GST, to the track of that. All this data in the hands of the consumer or small business can be used for their benefit. And this is going to be dramatic. The sudden data that's going to explode is going to be dramatic both on individuals and on businesses. And we think that that data, empowering the individual or the business and with the right kind of software, can enable them to use their own data for their own future. In other words, a small business can use its own data footprint to go to a lender and say, give me a loan. Yeah. And that will dramatically change credit about the data rate is something that's going to happen now. And then finally, what's going to happen on authentication? I know it's getting very technical and getting bored, but bear with me on this. You know, historically, people, you know, when you want to make some kind of a transaction, like a banking transaction, there's something called two-factor authentication. RBI says you should use two different ways of proving who you are before you can operate an account. You don't want fraud to happen. And historically, that used to be a card, a debit card, or a credit card, and a PIN number. So suppose you take your phone into the restaurant, then you swipe your card, then you get some gizmo, and then you enter a PIN, and then the payment is accepted. So the two factors there is what you are, what you have, which is a card, and what you know, which is a password. But increasingly, if everybody has a phone in their pocket, then the phone can become one factor. So the position of the phone itself is a factor. So if you can just connect your mobile number to your ID or your bank account, and then use that same mobile, then the bank knows that it is your mobile and therefore it's probably you, and that becomes one factor. And then you can use Aadhaar online authentication using your fingerprint or iris, that becomes the second factor. So suddenly, you can combine phone and Aadhaar, and you can have one-click, two-factor authentication for a billion people, imagine, on the phone. So everything can happen on the phone. And this is about to come. Already, there is a Samsung is launching a device by April, May. It's already pre-production. Which has, if you see, there's a regular camera in the middle and the top corner is another camera that's used for the iris. So can just look at this click and it does an authentication on Aadhaar. And it's a double two factor because the position of the device is one factor and the iris is the second factor. So suddenly you have created a nationwide system of simple two-factor authentication. So everything can be done in your form. So for example, you can provide, we talked about an example, it's a bit complicated, but fundamentally, why should a small shopkeeper get credit on their phone? Is there a way for them to use their own data to apply for a loan, build it out in the market, get the lenders to offer the thing, get the money electronically into the bank account? If you can do that, you will change the whole economy. Because today, only 3% of Indian businesses get credit from the formal system. 97% are relying on friends, family, all that stuff. So imagine if you can expand that. When every small business, there are 10 to 20 million small businesses, they can start getting loans from the banking system. And people say, you know, people want to remain, incognito, they don't want to pay tax, all that stuff, so they want all cash. But what we believe is that if entering the formal system allows you to get credit, then the cost of entering the formal system is less than the benefit, which is access to credit. So formalization and credit is a grand bargain. Come into the formal system, you get credit. That grand bargain will drive the formalization of India's economy, that more and more individuals will become part of the formal system, and more businesses will become part of the formal system. And that's the heart of economic growth of doing that. So I think the other thing is that all these things reduce the cost of operations. We did an analysis for SEBI, which showed that it costs anywhere from 700 to 1500 rupees to buy a mutual because wet signature, in-person verification, paperwork, all that messy stuff. Now, when the cost of buying a mutual fund is 1500 rupees, the investment to justify it for the distributor has to be at least 2 lakhs. Otherwise, it's not worth it because they just recover that 1500 bucks. And then we found that there are only 3 to 4 million households which can actually buy mutual funds. And that is a fact because there are only 10 million people in India who own mutual funds. The population of 1 billion is 1%. But if you can reduce the cost of owning a buying a mutual fund from 500 rupees to 10 rupees, which you can do using all this paperless, presenceless, cashless stuff, then suddenly even 2,000 rupee investment in the mutual fund is viable. And suddenly 100 million households can become mutual fund buyers. So this is not some abstract technology, this is about expanding and reducing costs so that more and more people can get access to services. So in some sense, what this technology is doing, it is marrying the market desire to expand market and social government desire to expand social inclusion are coming together. build a simple thing, and then on top of that, you build layer and layer and layer, ultimately create a whole new infrastructure of social change. Thank you very much.
Top 5-10%. Most people are And if they have access to credit, then they will produce more, they will grow, they will create jobs. So I think it's the, you can remove the friction in the economy and mobilize it. And it's just going to be a massive amount of jobs.
And before I go to the far end of it, on the left, I mean, balance it, and I'll come to the far end of
it. Historian of Pune.
Thanks for coming to Pune, first of all. Quick question. You mentioned about startups and reading about some of the activity happening in Bangalore. But how does this platform help startups? Can you talk about a few examples? What startups are already doing and what can startups in Pune do to specifically build something interesting in this area?
No, this is not only Bangalore startups. No, I'll give you an example. There's a startup called Better Place. Just got funded last 2 weeks back. We got a funding of about $1 million from the United States Fund. And it's a very interesting company. They come from the, they provide, the founder was heading a company that provided security people, right? Now what's happening in India, you have massive migration happening, right? And we don't have any trust system. We have no way of knowing who the guy is. And there will be some episode, some rape case, and everybody's in, you know, the big thing. So is there a way to build a trust system using Aadhaar? So what they're doing is, using Aadhaar as a base, they are trained, anybody who comes to them, the verification is done around Aadhaar. So that when that guy goes to their work somewhere, that security sort of like a rating is given to that employer. Suddenly they're reducing the friction of hiring. Because you're not hiring some unknown person, you're hiring a known person. And they're getting a massive thing, so that they're calling it safety as a service or security as a service. Other people are building mobile apps for lending, where they tie up the bank and then using Aadhaar for deciding whether the guy is lendable to. So lots and lots of stuff. It's up, the sky is the limit. It's like the internet. You could not have thought 15 years back that there'd be Twitter or something like that. It just happened.
Thank you.
When the election
commission took on the electronic voting card, voting, you know, ID system 20 years back. They did it in a decentralized manner. So they got each state would have different vendors. So there's a lot of systems, it's not interoperable. So they need to really create a centralized database of voters, make it online, link it to Aadhaar, and then provide. So when I change my address, I should just switch on the phone. I can only vote once. Now people are voting in one city, and after 1 week they go again voting in some other place. So all that, absolutely, that can be curbed. In fact, the election commission had very enthusiastically started seeding Aadhaar into the voter database. But then the Supreme Court business, and they sort of backed off on that. It'll happen in a few years. The detailed design in the book.
Thank you. I think that's chapter 9, page 171, just to help you with it. And thank you. I guess I'll just go to the far right. That's very surprising. We haven't given a chance to lady asking a question, but I think if I go back to my PICT, you know, I'll not be spared. So there's a lady asking the question, that's the next one.
What is new in education through IIT?
Okay, well.
Obviously, there will be a lot of hiccups, there will be a lot of challenges, but it's a hell of a lot better than what it used to be.
Thank you so much. We'll close the question and answer session here. And I just have a tiny announcement to say that a copy of this book that we're talking about today would be available just outside after the program, immediately after the program. You could always have a look at that, go through it. Or those of you who would like to buy it, you could buy it there. And we are requesting the minute to please spare a few more minutes to autograph those books. Thank you. Now may I request the chairperson of the program, and I'll be happy that we talk about the innovation and what people suggest.
So finally, I think all these things we have to consider. The last point that I want to make is the following, that India is changing very rapidly. I was in Rajiv Pawar the other day when I actually found it. And he was telling me something interesting that he was walking on a street, and he saw a street vendor, a 75-year-old, park said something. But he's close to the vehicle, so he went to it and said, now people will be surprised. So he said, Gigi. So he put his photograph, and then he was walking out. That 80-year-old sitting on the park is in some middle of a massacre. That's the new idea. The other India that we will be, and I'm aiming at this, is the body. Satyam Shyam Sundar, Satyam Nadella became the CEO of Microsoft, Sundar Pichai, Aeroport. So I'm having a conversation with some young people. And one of them said, you know, our dream used to be go to US somehow. In fact, all of you said that in 1964, that was the dream. You know, personal conversation. Then the dream was, have a job in Microsoft or Google. And then the dream changed to becoming the CEO of Microsoft. And I'm happy to tell you one young girl about it. As you know, that's not our dream. We want to create a lot more Microsofts, more Googles here. If those young people were there, they would not have said, we'd like to create our own Microsofts here in the case of work. What they would have said is that we want to become another director. And that inspiration that you have provided, not only to your life, to your inspiring work, so the country is grateful to you. And thank you very much for giving us this opportunity to be able to say thank you to you. So thank you for being what you are. Thank you for having done what you have. And there's a long way to go, as I have seen. Your dream of Rebooting India will come through the technology transformation that you have been teaching us a lot, and that's the path that we have to follow. Thank you all very much for coming to the
I guess there's only a minute away between now and announcing that we are done putting the program. So, first of all, we'll begin the vote of thanks by presenting a tiny token of appreciation from PIC to Nandan Nilekani. So may I request Dr. Mashindra to please present a tiny token of appreciation. It's all about books, so that's a book about Pune. That's what we are doing. Take it out there and communicate it to the people who couldn't come today.